today, rise up. We have legs today. We have feet. We have hands to praise the Lord. We have our mouths. There's some people that don't have a voice. There's some people that don't have hearing. Praise the Lord that we have our faculties this morning. We do have hands, hallelujah. When it comes to other things, we have lots of hands. We have legs when the other music, when the worldly music is playing, suddenly you want to dance. But what happens when it comes to God? What shuts us down? Do you want to know what it is? It's those demons that we allow that will give entry. If you give the devil a little finger, he takes the whole hand. So come on this morning, brothers and sisters. Let's get some life in us. We're standing on holy ground this morning. Hallelujah. We serve a mighty God. Don't be shy. Let go of your inhibitions this morning. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We serve a mighty God. Bow your heads in prayer, brothers and sisters. Close your eyes this morning. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, I invite you into our midst. Dear Father, first of all, I cover each and every brother and sister with your precious blood, Jesus. Our children, O God. Those that thought they want to come this morning and decided, no, it's not the day for me. I pray for them, Lord Jesus, that they will have a conviction in their heart that this is the day that the Lord has made. Tomorrow may not be your day. Hallelujah. We serve Almighty God, Lord Jesus. Convict their hearts even now, Lord Jesus. Convict them, Jesus. Because we need the last days. The coming of the Lord is soon. And in this earth, God is in heaven. And if you're wondering why God is not doing this and that in your life, why things are not changing for me, it is because you're not living a life of prayer. When you pray, you bring down the glory of God. Hallelujah. You bring down the miracles. Hallelujah. You bring down the signs and wonders. It's not just on the hands of its own. God is in heaven, brothers and sisters. God is in your heart. He's waiting for you. He's waiting for you to call on His glory. Miracles only take place where there's the glory of God, because not where there's the glory of man. Where the glory of God is, signs, wonders, and miracles are sure to take place. Hallelujah! Don't sit back, brothers and sisters. Call on those miracles in your life. Call on the healing in your life. You're not supposed to be sick. I say you're not supposed to be sick, brothers. If you're sick today, there's something wrong. There's something wrong. Hallelujah! You're supposed to be well this morning. You're supposed to live a life of victory. Don't be distracted this morning, brothers and sisters. Bow your heads in prayer. Listen to the word of God this morning speaking to you. Don't sit back and relax. The Lord brought you through first COVID, second COVID, then maybe a third and a fourth, and the Lord will bring you through. Hallelujah! Because we serve a mighty God this morning. The virus shall not come near you. Know your dwelling place. It's not allowed to enter your yard. When you serve the Lord in the spirit and the truth, it's not supposed to enter your car. It's not supposed to follow you. It's supposed to shut away, brothers and sisters, when it sees you. You got the dunamis power of God in you. Hallelujah, this morning. There's no time for games. There's no time to come to church. And you're coming to see who's wearing what, or who's dressed with your hair shabby. Come to church, brothers and sisters. The Lord will change that for you. Suddenly you will shine on the inside and the outside. The Lord will dress you up. He will give you purpose. He will give you life. It's not about your age. It's not about age, it's just a number. But old is a state of mind. You're not old, brothers and sisters. It's a state of mind that's robbing you. When you dwell in the house of God, when you serve God, He renews your power. He gives you supernatural power. He gives you grace. When you make Him your source, you will find supernatural miracles upon you. Brothers and sisters, make God your Father. Make Him your boss. Make Him the boss of the boss in your life. It's not your manager that pays you. God pays your salary. Hallelujah. So give God the first glory. Hallelujah. Because remember what you did on earth. When you take it away in a snap of a finger, don't lose the life that you have. Just because of selfishness, laziness, slothfulness, when the Holy Spirit is waking you up in the morning, get up to pray. Be that pillar in your home. Pray for your children. Pray for your husband. Pray for the church. Somebody, God needs intercession. Like you're not sitting down today, brothers and sisters. God needs intercessors in this last days. Hallelujah. He needs someone praying for someone. He needs someone praying for the church. God needs, you know, people put intercessors down, but God needs someone praying for someone. God needs you praying for your children. God needs you praying for the country. God needs you praying for the president. What are you doing at home? I need gossiping and phone calls and WhatsApping. No, check that, turn that around and sit with the word of God. Find the word of God early in the morning and at night when you go to sleep. Father, I thank you for this morning. And Father, Lord, I'm not preaching this morning. But I thank you, Jesus, so God, for the life that you've given to me and to each and every one of us. I welcome the Holy Spirit, so God, thank you, Holy Spirit. And I thank each and every one of our angels that ease us every day's load, that carry us when we cannot carry ourselves. Angels, I thank you that you take our children to school, that you look after our babies. Thank you, Lord, angels of God, that move in on our behalf. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for the comfort we get from you. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that when we're wrong, you convict us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that we live a life of pureness. That's what God's looking for. God don't want you to go unforgiveness. God don't want you bad-mouthing somebody. God don't want you hating on anybody. Because it's too short of a life to live that life. That life is meaningless. Live a life that flows. Be like a river that flows. Be so pure. Have no hate in your heart. Suddenly you will find you've changed. You cannot hate anymore. You just walk past and you know those are your enemies. But I thank God for enemies because they put you on the right track. They make you want to pray for them. They give you something to pray about. Hallelujah. They give you something to be so grateful for. They give you something to know that you're on the right road. They show you you're on the right road. Hallelujah. So thank God even for your enemies. Oh, thank you, Jesus, this morning. We want to thank you, Father. We want to thank you for this glorious day that you rose from the dead, Jesus. So that we, Lord Jesus, have eternal life. We have a life in you, Jesus, oh God. Thank you, God, for this life. This life that will carry us all through journey, this life's journey. Oh, Father, such a glorious life. Where the warmth of the sun never ceases on your life. Where you always feel God's grace in your life. Where you live like a rose, like a flower in the field. Where you live so such a glorious life. It doesn't mean that the joy of the Lord doesn't bring that sometimes you won't face circumstances. You won't face real life. Yes, you will. But there will be a joy in you that just overrides all of that. There will be something in you. You may not be smiling, but there's a joy. Hallelujah. We have that joy as children of God. We live such a glorious life. So forgive today, brothers and sisters. It's a good day to let go of all the things that have held you down. Let go today, brothers and sisters, of all the sickness. Even tell that to go away today. Let go of pain. Let go of things that have attached themselves to you. Because we allow those things, brothers and sisters. We know that God said we are healed this morning. Hallelujah. Don't allow those things in your life to attach themselves to you. You have the power to dust them off this morning. And I want you to dance and praise the Lord today, brothers and sisters. Let us kick off. If it means getting off your shoes or getting off your handbag, sit down, brothers. God has done so much for us this morning. Hallelujah. Don't come and waste. Don't waste your day and waste your time, brothers and sisters. Kenneth Copeland said he'd rather preach to one person all his life and trust in God to bring in the souls. Hallelujah. So we trust God this morning. We may be one today, but we are mighty in God. Hallelujah. We serve a mighty. We will be seated this morning, brothers and sisters. Praise the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, brothers and sisters. We serve a mighty, mighty, mighty God. We serve a great God. And I thank you, Lord Jesus, oh God, for your praises, Father. You've done so much for us. This morning I want to read a small daily devotion for you. The title says, Don't Speak, Shout Your Victory. Amen. From the rising of the sun unto the going down of the saint, the Lord's name is to be praised. It's from Psalm 113, verse 3. Praise God. Praise Him in the morning, praise Him at noon, praise Him at night. If you've never praised God in your life, then get started right now. Praise Him for freedom, brothers and sisters. Praise Him for healing and Calvary. Praise Him for the name of Jesus. There's power in that name. Hallelujah. You ought to be shouting your way to work, shouting your way back home. If there's anything the devil can't stand, it's praise. If you've taken territory from the devil and he's coming against you to get it back, this is not the time to sit down and whine about how things aren't working out. It's not the time to decide that God has taken His hand off your life. It is the time to get into the Word and get yourself re-anchored in God's promises. It is time to keep these promises constantly before your eyes and in your heart. It is time to pray. And the prayer of faith shall... the prayer of faith, and take your stand on the basis of His provision. It's time to continue to do the things you know to do. When Satan starts shaking your mountain, don't retreat and run for cover. Speak to the mountain with the authority you wield in the name of Jesus Christ. Then, when you've done that, start to praise and shout the victory. You don't have to be afraid of Satan. He'll be afraid of you. Hallelujah. There's a scripture reading. You can read Psalms 50. Praise the Lord this morning. We serve a mighty God. Hallelujah. Don't mind the weather. Don't mind anything this morning. We came to praise the Lord. We came to praise the Lord for a great week. We came to praise the Lord for a great year. We still have made up much blessings. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Don't let the blessing of tomorrow slip away. Who knows, maybe there's a blessing right now for you, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. Grab a hold of what God has for us. God has something for each and every one of you today. You're so special, brothers and sisters. God loves us and God loves you this morning. Praise His name. Thank God for our pastor this morning, that the Spirit will give us the word this morning, a word from God, a word blessed in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Oh, we thank you, Lord. We came, Father, today only for you, Jesus. Lord, thank you, Father. We have to leave. We sometimes think maybe we have to leave everything at home in a standstill. It's good, brothers and sisters. Those things carry no weight. Leave everything and run for Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise His name. Amen.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. We just rise this morning to praise the Lord. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you.
the one who made the world is your Father. Amen. Can you say the one who made the world is my Father? And if he is my Father, then I don't have to worry about anything. Hallelujah. Because he's the one who made the world. When he made this world, he had you in mind. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So you are catered for. You are covered. Hallelujah. Wow. Amen. He is really a good God.
Amen.
Every day should be a celebration. Each time we meet, we should uplift his name. He deserves the glory. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He deserves the praise at all times.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Not sometimes. Not when we feel like it. Not when we're excited, but at all times. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Well, welcome, brothers and sisters. This is God's house.
Amen.
Tell the person sitting next to you that you've done a great thing by coming to God's house.
You've done a great thing by coming to God's house.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Mine is to do the offering. Can we have some lights, please? Amen. The word for offering. I have titled it, God Gives Us the Best Gifts.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God gives us the best gifts.
Amen.
I looked up the meaning of the word best. Best means of the most excellent or desirable type of quality. That is the meaning of the word best. And that is what your Father wants for you. He wants to give you the best gifts. There's excellence in that because he's God. Hallelujah.
Okay.
God is God and he's excellent. God does not make mistakes.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Right.
Perhaps we can look at what he has given us and complain, but we need to remember all the time that this is God and he does not make a mistake.
Okay.
Amen. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You can even taste. Taste involves your senses. You can taste, you can see that the Lord is good. Hallelujah. We serve a good God. God gave humanity the best gift. That is his only begotten son. Amen. And that is Jesus. That is John 3, verse 16. Amen. A true father is a giver. Fathers give. Fathers give their children. Fathers have their children's interests at heart. They want to give. Hallelujah. You are not a father because you can make babies. You are a father because you are a giver. Hallelujah.
That's
we should
right.
be encouraged. That should encourage
yeah.
us to give.
That's right.
We give. Hallelujah. God is perfect and does not make mistakes. Therefore, whatever he gives us will also be perfect. James 1, James chapter 1 verse 17, you can read that at home. It says, every good and perfect gift is from above.
Amen.
Coming down from the Father,
Amen.
There is that word Father. Coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. And I looked at these shifting shadows.
Mm.
That man shift. That's why we ought to look unto God, because he will not shift.
Yeah.
God will never shift.
Amen.
God will remain there. He's constant. Things might change around us, but God will remain there. He's not a shifting shadow. Amen.
Hallelujah.
So we don't have to, we must not doubt him. Hallelujah. We must trust God because he does not change his nature, he does not change his nature of giving. He is the custodian of everything that is good.
Ooh.
Everything that is good, you must know that it is from God.
Amen.
Don't look elsewhere. It is God. This is the goodness of God. He is God, the giver, who is going to give you the best gifts. Amen. Romans 8, verse 32 says, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Therefore, when we ask in his name, he will give us the best. Hallelujah.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Please receive the word for yourselves this morning.
Amen.
God is prepared to give us, to us. He keeps the best things for us and not from us. Hallelujah. Let me repeat that. He keeps the best things for us and not from us. Hallelujah.
Wow.
So we have access to those things. He's keeping them for us. Perhaps we need to ask.
Hey.
Eh? If he's keeping them for us, therefore we must ask. They are there. They are waiting for us. Hallelujah. All we have to do is to ask. Perhaps we don't ask. Remember that verse which says, ask so that your joy may be full. This is really amazing. God wants us to ask. Perhaps we don't receive because we don't ask. So it's time we ask our Father. And also bearing in mind that he is the giver of best gifts. He will give you the best. When I was preparing the message, I was led into Matthew chapter 7, from verse 7 to 11, where the word talks about asking. Ask, seek, knock. You know, this is an instruction. It's a command that we must ask. When we are in need, we must ask. We must ask our Father. We said God is a giver. God is our Father and therefore he gives. He is a Father because he gives. Those who are fathers, you are fathers because you are givers. Perhaps you can overlook the fact that you are a maid, but you should be a father because you are a giver. Hallelujah. We must ask. He's prepared to give us. We must seek. We are going to find. Actually, when you read, it tells you that those who ask shall do what? They will find. Those who seek, what is going to happen?
They will
find. And those who know, what is going to happen? The door will be opened. So are we doing this? We ought to ask. We ought to seek. We ought to know. When we ask, it will find answers. We will be answered. When we knock, the door will be opened. When we seek, we shall find.
Amen.
It's guaranteed. God is instructing us to do. Hallelujah. So you can read that. It's Matthew chapter 7, from verse 7 to 11.
Amen.
And lastly, it is important that we see God as our Father. He is a loving Father who wants to give to us. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The word of God says, blessed is the hand that gives. Blessed is the hand that gives. We cannot be at the receiving end at all times. We cannot say we'll just receive and receive and receive from God. Surely, if God is our Father, there should be a resemblance between a father and a child. There should be a resemblance. If God is a giver, we should also be givers. Hallelujah. We cannot be at the receiving end at all times. Children copy what their fathers do. Jesus also said that he did what he saw his father doing, and he said what God was saying. Hallelujah. So as parents, we should live that kind of life that is appealing to God and to everyone. We should be giving, because children tend to copy what their parents do. Amen.
Amen.
If God gives to us what is good and perfect, we must also do the same. Let us give generously and be faithful in our giving. Amen.
Amen.
If we give, we make God our source. Amen.
Amen.
God becomes our source. He is your source. He is a source that will never run dry. Amen.
Amen.
He is a fountain that will never run dry. We don't have to run to your rich relatives to ask for help.
Amen.
We ought to go to God. I'm sure our relatives have disappointed us several times. They can't help us. They will say, no, I don't have money this time. But with God, God will never let you down.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He's a fountain that will never run dry. Two, God is your sustainer. God is your sustainer. What is to sustain? To sustain is to preserve and to maintain. Okay? God will preserve and maintain your possessions because you give. So you don't have to worry about whatever you possess because God is our sustainer. And lastly, God is your defender. God will defend what you have. God will defend you. God will defend what you have. Remember Psalms 91?
Yeah.
He will rebuke the devourer from destroying your crop, from stealing from you.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He is our defender. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. So we don't have to worry about whatever we have because he is our source. He is our sustainer. He is our defender. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. He will protect and shield your possessions. Praise the Lord. And in closing, Proverbs chapter 11, verse 24 says, there is one who scatters, yet increases more. And there is one who withholds more than is right, but it leads to poverty.
Yeah.
So when we hold, at the end, we are going straight to poverty. We must give, we must scatter, we must give, so that we see an increase in our lives. May you be blessed this morning as you give. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You can take out your chairs and your notebooks and be ready for the word of God. Let's all honor our pastor as he comes forward to bless us with the word. Amen.
Hallelujah.
God
is good.
All the time.
God is good. Tell your neighbor, neighbor.
My God is good.
I serve a good God. It's good to me.
It's good to you.
It's good to everybody. And he's been just so good to me. I say he's been just so good to me. Hallelujah. Praise God. If you believe that, give the Lord praise this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Would we bow our heads as we just pray? Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, your Son, our Lord and Savior, thank you this morning for another opportunity, O God, to share your precious word. Thank you, Lord God, that we're two or more gathered in your name. There you are in the midst of it. Yes, O Lord God, we acknowledge your presence here this morning. O Lord God, we give honor to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, your Son, the one who emptied himself, who gave himself wholly and freely, so that through his sacrifice we might be saved. Thank you, Lord God, for the blood of Jesus, which speaks on our behalf. For it's by the blood, O Lord, that we have the means and the way of entry, O Lord God, into the Holy of Holies. It's through the blood, O Lord God, that we've been reconciled to you. It's by the blood, O God, that we have received redemption, we've received mercy, we've received, Lord, remission, forgiveness of sin. By the blood we have been saved, we have been healed, we have been delivered, O God. Lord God, we thank you this morning. Because of the blood, we are in a better place. We have a better covenant. O Lord God, we just thank you this morning that Jesus Christ paid the price for us. And we acknowledge that price. We thank you, Lord, for the empty tomb. Because Jesus lives, we live. So we thank you, Lord, that we have a living hope. Thank you for the glorious future that you've prepared for us in Christ Jesus, your Son. Thank you that we may experience, Lord, the resurrection of Christ whilst on earth in our daily lives. We see your power at work in us, O God. And we thank you for your word. We thank you for the preaching and the teaching of your word. I pray this morning, O God, that as your word will come forth, that you will breathe life into your word. That, Lord, O God, your word will find a dwelling place in the hearts of men and women that are gathered in this place, those that are watching us via whatever platform, Father. That your word will be sown in their hearts. O Lord God, I pray in the name of Jesus. That, Lord, O God, the word that you sent, that as we receive it, as we hear it, that faith will come. In the name of Jesus, that your people, Lord, will stand upon your promises. And as they stand, O God, I thank you, you'll bring them through time after time after time after time. The testimony of your faithfulness, your goodness. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. O Lord God, anoint my mouth. Anoint, O Lord God, my tongue to declare your word to your people, that the word of God will have free course this morning, that it will come forth, Lord, unhindered, undisturbed from any satanic maneuverment or strategy in the name of Jesus. And come up against every spirit that is not of the living God. In the name of Jesus, I decree that Jesus Christ is Lord. I decree the word of God will flow freely. I decree that the word of God will find its resting place in the lives of the people of God. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Lord of God, we give you thanks, and we give you praise, we give you glory, we give you honor, we give you the worship. In your blessed name we pray, and the people of God say, amen, amen, amen. Come and give the Lord praise this morning. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome. It's good to be in the presence of the Lord this morning. The Bible says in his presence is fullness of joy. Hallelujah. This morning we have come to celebrate. Amen. Our celebration is just not one day. Our celebration is daily. Tell your neighbor, daily, I'm celebrating. Tell your neighbor, I don't know about you, but for me, I'm celebrating every day. What are we celebrating? We are celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, the Messiah. Hallelujah. Amen. We do not serve a dead God. Our God is alive. The tomb is there to prove it. The tomb is empty. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Well, praise God. Amen. Is there anybody visiting us for the first time, visiting us this morning, visiting us, just raise your right hand. Nobody. Amen. Well, praise God. Welcome to the whole church. Welcome to everybody. Amen. Praise God. I believe we're going to have an awesome time this morning in the presence of the Lord. And I want to begin first by sharing with you the table of the Lord. I mentioned to you on Friday that today we will have the table of the Lord. I encourage you to bring your communion emblems. I trust that you've done that. Amen. It doesn't matter whether it's water, whether it is, you know, juice, whatever. It doesn't matter. Those are his emblems signifying his body, signifying his blood. Amen. Now, if you don't have, would you just raise your hand so I can just ask Pastor Sharon to give you some. If you don't have, all right, Pastor Sharon, would you just give? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We've got one there in the back. Brother Phillips. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I want you to go with me to the book of Genesis, the fourth chapter. And I want to share with you about the blood. On Friday, shared with you about applying the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. And I shared with you how you apply the blood of Jesus daily in your life. If you weren't here on Friday, I believe Kurt will be uploading the video soon. Pastor Sharon, you'd like a copy, you can speak to Kurt and he'll arrange a copy for you. Hallelujah. I share with you how you apply the blood of Jesus. Because the book of Revelation teaches us that they overcame him. And who's they? Speaking of us, saints of God. We overcame who? Satan, the devil. How? By the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. There's power in the blood. I said there's power in the blood. Amen. Now, if we read from Genesis chapter 4, and I want to start from verse number 8, the Bible says, "Now Cain talked with Abel his brother, and it came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel his brother and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is Abel your brother? He said, I do not know, am I my brother's keeper? What a nerve. And he said, speaking of the Lord, what have you done? I want you to underline that. What have you done? The voice of your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. I want you to highlight that, underline that. God says, the voice of your brother's blood cries out to me from where? From the ground. You see, blood has a voice. Blood has a voice. And we find now that God pronounces judgment upon Cain. He pronounces judgment by virtue of the blood. And the blood of Cain cried out from the ground. It cried out vengeance. You with me? Because the life, the Bible in the book of Leviticus tells us that the life of all flesh is in the blood. The life of all flesh is in the blood. And here we have Abel, whose blood was shed against his will. It was shed against his will, and because it was against his will, we find that the blood cried, because it was not his will to die. Come on, somebody. It was not his will to die. He did not will to die. So his blood cried out, and God heard it, and it spoke from where? It spoke from the ground. It spoke from the earth. And then we find now, in contrast to that, Jesus, the Son of God, Jesus gave his blood willingly. Jesus gave his blood willingly. In other words, Jesus, watch it, Jesus emptied himself. Why? He emptied himself because in the fallen state of man, man was empty. There was a void in the life of man. Man was not complete. Hence we find that Jesus emptied himself. He emptied himself so that we can be full. Come on, somebody. When Jesus rose from the dead and the woman meets him, Jesus tells her, do not touch me. Because the body that he rose with was a glorified body. It was glorified in the sense that it had no blood. It was flesh and bone. Because understand this, Christ is our high priest. In the old Levitical priesthood, the Levites used to take the offering, the sin offering, and they would tie bangles to their ankles. Not bangles, bells. They would tie bells to their ankles. And as they would walk, they would hear the bells. And if the sound of the bells ceased, it meant that God was not pleased with the sacrifice, hence for that year, for the next year. The whole nation of Israel, their lives were at stake. It was dependent upon that animal that they offered as a sacrifice. And if it was not acceptable to God, then the bells would cease. They would not hear the bells. And when they pulled the cord out, because they would tie a cord to him, and when they pull out the body, they pull out the corpse. And that meant that they were dead. That meant that they would go into famine. That meant it would not be well with them. But if God, when God received and accepted that sacrifice, they still heard the bells. The Levite walked out, and all of Israel would rejoice, because what that was significant was, is that the next year would be a fruitful year. It would mean that God was with them. It would mean that whatever enemy came up against them, they would prevail against the enemy, because God had accepted the sacrifice. Now here we have Jesus, our high priest. He's not a high priest according to the Levitical priesthood. He belongs to the priesthood of Melchizedek, amen, who was the king of Salem. Amen. He's been made a priest forever according to the priesthood of Melchizedek. Amen. A priesthood that is forever, an everlasting priesthood. And he is our high priest. And he did not take the blood of an animal to put upon the mercy seat in heaven. It was his own blood. Amen. That's why he told her, do not touch me. Because it is still not fulfilled. He had to ascend to the Father. He said, go and tell my brothers, go and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father. Amen. You understand? Because before that, they were regarded as friends. But because of the blood brought them into the family. They now had a father. They now belonged to another family. It's called the family of God. And when Jesus had placed the blood on the mercy seat in heaven, remember the mercy seat on earth, it was a replica of what was in heaven. The real one was in heaven. That's why nobody talks about the ark of the covenant that was made on the earth, but there's a greater ark, a greater covenant that is in heaven. And Jesus placed his blood upon the mercy seat in heaven, and then he comes and he appears to his disciples. And then we get a Thomas. Somebody say Thomas. Yeah, you get a doubter. You get a doubter that doesn't believe unless they see. Unless I see, I don't believe. And Jesus says, look, touch me. Touch me. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones. He did not speak of the blood, because the blood was on the mercy seat. The blood of Abel cried out for vengeance. It cried for vengeance. The blood of Jesus cries out mercy and forgiveness. The blood of Jesus cries out mercy and forgiveness. God says, I have mercy upon you. God says, I forgive you. That's the difference between the blood of Abel and the blood of Jesus. So God has mercy upon The blood of Abel speaks on the earth. The blood of Jesus speaks in heaven. You see that? The blood of Jesus speaks in heaven. Therefore, we can now boldly come to the throne of grace and obtain mercy and receive an abundance of grace to help us in our time of need because of the blood. Hallelujah. Not by what we have done. Not by what we have wrote. Now we all know, hallelujah, on the night when Jesus was betrayed, he sat at the table. And to show that there's no partiality with God, we find that Judas himself, the one who would betray him, was also there at the Lord's table. He was also there. Judas was there. That's why he even questioned and said, who is it? Everybody, they all questioned, who is it? Jesus said, the one who dips his bread together with me. And it was Judas. So he was there. And on the night when he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which is given for you. See, this is my body, which is given for you. When supper was ended, he took the cup after he blessed it, gave it to his disciples, and he said, take this, all of you, not some of you, all of you, for this is my blood in the new covenant. This is my blood in the new covenant given for the remission of the sin of the world. You see, without blood, there is no remission. Without blood, there is no remission. Hallelujah. Paul goes on to say that for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes in glory. Amen. Let us bow our heads as we pray. Father, this morning we thank you, Lord God, for a glorious opportunity as your people that we could gather together, Lord God, to celebrate what Jesus Christ, your Son, has done for us. We thank you for the body of Christ, which was broken for us. Broken, Lord God, to bring us completeness. The stripes upon his body, by his stripes, we were healed. It is by his body, Lord God, that his body has become the veil by which we might enter into the most holy of holies. We thank you, Lord God, for the blood that Christ Jesus shed for us. By his blood we have received, Lord God, redemption. We've received, Lord God, remission. And we thank you for this now. Thank you, O Lord God, that by the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ upon the mercy seat, we receive mercy. We receive, O Lord God, forgiveness. We thank you now, O Lord, that through Jesus Christ, your Son, we are able to serve you in a new and a living way. In your blessed name, O Lord Jesus, we pray. And God's people say, amen, amen, and amen. Praise God. Give the Lord praise. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. The body of Christ, let us partake. Say, thank you, Lord Jesus, for your blood, which has sealed the victory that you won for me. I declare victory is mine. Victory is mine. And I celebrate that victory. In your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Come and give the Lord praise this morning.
Hallelujah.
Give him praise. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'd like to encourage you every day, in fact, often as you can, in your home, have communion. Have communion. You know, sometimes we are so diligent. When the doctor gives you medication, we are so diligent to take the medication. The doctor tells you, in 3 days' time, you'll feel a lot better. Well, you know what the paracetamol cannot do, and what the medication cannot do, the blood of Jesus can do. I say the blood of Jesus can do. The blood of Jesus will heal everything in your body, everything in your life. Hallelujah. The blood of Jesus will bring healing to your relationship in your home, relationship with your spouse, with your children, with your family. The blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Well, a happy Easter to all of you. Hallelujah. Happy Easter to all of you. A blessed Resurrection Day to everyone. Now, reminded in the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter number 15. Let's just go there quickly. And 1 Corinthians chapter 15. You know, yesterday we celebrated the life and the graduation of one of our brethren, Sister Ntombi Khona, who's gone on to be with the Lord. And I shared with him yesterday that it was amazing. It is amazing. That, you know, we celebrate the graduation over Easter. Because what is Easter all about? Easter is about the crucifixion of Jesus, the death of Jesus, the burial of Jesus. Most importantly, the resurrection of Jesus. That is the core of our gospel. That is the core of our message, is the resurrection. Tell your neighbor, without the resurrection, there is no Christianity. It is incomplete. It is incomplete. You understand, there is no gospel without the resurrection. Because what is the gospel? Gospel is good news. Good news is not somebody that has died and is buried and has been put in the grave. That's not good news. That is sad news. But good news, gospel, is that that person that you saw, that they buried and was dead, you see that person being raised to life. Praise God. The Bible says he's the firstborn from the dead because he is risen. Come and talk to me, somebody. Because he is risen, we too partake of his resurrection. If we partake of his death, if we partake of his burial, come and talk to me. We are also partakers of his resurrection. Tell somebody, I don't know about you, but I'm a partaker of the resurrection. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 15 verse 14 says, and if Christ is not risen, then our preaching of the gospel is empty and your faith is also Christ is not risen, then we have an empty gospel and we have an empty faith. But you can go to the tomb today. It is empty. And because the tomb is empty, hallelujah, we have a living hope. We have a living faith. We have a powerful message, a powerful gospel. The enemy thought that he was done with Jesus. And they said, "Let's perchance we heard his disciples and we heard him saying that he will rise. Let us put guards there. Let us put a big stone." So they rolled a stone before the tomb and they even put guards. They even put soldiers there. The Bible says that there was an earthquake. There was an earthquake. And you know what? The soldiers, it took their breath away. They fainted. When they went in Gethsemane, when they came to arrest Jesus, the Bible says the soldiers asked, "We are looking for Jesus of Nazareth." The Bible says Jesus responded and said, "I am he." When he said, "I am he," they fell under the power of God. What was it that caused them to fall? It was the anointing. Let me tell you something. Adam lost the authority and the dominion that God had given humanity. He lost it in the garden. And Jesus came to restore it. We find it in that same, "Come and talk to me," in the garden. When they said, "Where we are looking for this Jesus of Nazareth," Jesus said, "I am he." And they fell. They all, watch it, they fell. And then they got soldiers to stand before the tomb. What were they guarding? They thought the disciples would come. You see, our God doesn't need help to prove that he is God. Our God doesn't need help to prove that he is alive. He is God himself. And all of a sudden there was an earthquake. And the stone, watch it, when the stone was rolled away, these guys lost it. What was it? That was power. You know what it was? It was the anointing. It was the power of the Holy Ghost. Romans 8 tells us, if the same spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead, are you hearing me? The same spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. Come and talk to me. He who raised Christ from the dead will quicken your mortal bodies. That means the body of Jesus was dead, laid down, but the spirit entered the body. And when that body rose up, it was a glorified body. That body had an anointing. That body had an anointing. What is the anointing? The anointing is the presence of God. It's the power of God. Come and talk to me, somebody. The bones of the prophet Elijah, the bones of the prophet were in a tomb. And these robbers were going to bury their friend. And they put the corpse into that tomb. As soon as the corpse connected with the bones of the prophet, the man came to life. It's the anointing. Hallelujah. Praise God. So if you celebrate the resurrection once a year, you are missing out. Tell your neighbor you are missing out. Because you can live and you can walk in the resurrection every day. He is risen. Christ is risen. This is a special day. Hallelujah. Because of the resurrection, there is power. Come on, what a power this is. What power, what love. Hallelujah. Praise God. The death of Jesus was all a part of God's great plan of redemption. What Adam gave over to Satan in the Garden of Eden by disobedience was taken back by one perfect man's obedience, and that man is Jesus Christ. By the transgression of one man, all have sinned. The wages of sin is death. So what happened? Because all sinned, all died. But by one man's obedience, much more are all made righteous. Much more are all given life. Much more. Somebody say, in Christ I've received life. In other words, to put it simply, what God did was He reclaimed the blessing that was stolen in Eden. God reclaimed the blessing. Somebody say the blessing. God reclaimed the blessing, and what else God done? God got His family back. God got His family back. Listen, if somebody is trying to attack the home, you'll find that the man of that house will do all he can to preserve his family and defend his family. Our God is our Father. And God has a family. And that is you and I. Whilst we were in sin, we were lost, we were dead, living a life that is a dead end life. God sent Jesus to die for us, so that through His death, we might receive mercy. We might receive forgiveness. We might receive reconciliation. I shared that with you on Friday. Reconciliation, the ministry of reconciliation. God has reconciled us to Himself. God got back His family. He gave us back the dominion and authority that rightfully belongs to us, His children. Tell your neighbor, I received the authority and dominion that rightfully belongs to me, a child of God. Hallelujah. Let us go to Colossians chapter 2. Colossians 2. Thank you, Jesus. Colossians chapter 2 and verse number 15. I want you all to read this out loud. 1, 2, go. Read it one more time. It says, having disarmed principalities and powers, He made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in His cross. I want to try to pick it up from verse 14, then you'll get the gist of it. It says, having wiped out, somebody say, wipe out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us. And He has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. You see that? Everything that was required of us, everything that was required of us to pay for that debt, the debt of sin, He took it and He nailed it on the cross. Hallelujah. And the Bible says He wiped it out of the way. having disarmed principalities. In other words, having disarmed principles. You must understand, God is a God of principle. He works by principle. There are principles of the kingdom. And Satan cannot create anything. What Satan does is he takes what God has created and he distorts it. He cannot create. He cannot create havoc in your life. He cannot. He's not a creator. He'll take what God has created and he'll distort it. He'll twist it. Hallelujah. So he's a distorter. Now Jesus disarmed those principles that Satan operated by. He disarmed principalities and powers. He made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. Hallelujah. So Jesus triumphed. He triumphed over the devil. Come and talk to me, somebody. He triumphed over the devil. He triumphed over principalities. He triumphed over powers. He triumphed over the kingdom of darkness. The kingdom of darkness has no power over a child of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He disarmed every power that would ever come up against you. To be disarmed. What does it mean to be disarmed? It means you have no arms. You cannot fight. Satan, come on, talk to me, somebody. Can somebody, listen, you all watch boxing, right? You've watched boxing at some time or the other. Or wrestling, let's look at wrestling. Most of the young children will know about wrestling. If a wrestler got into the ring and his opponent was disarmed, no arms, and defeated, no feet, what are his chances of losing the match? Come on. If the opponent, I mean, even you, having had no experience in wrestling, Brother Jimmy, you get into the ring, I mean, you prepared yourself, you exercised yourself, but you never had a match. But now you get into the ring, and the opponent that you are facing has no arms and no feet. What are your chances of losing? What are your chances of losing? You cannot lose. You cannot fail. You can only win. You can only triumph. Why? Because somebody else defeated him on your behalf. You are walking in his victory. You understand? What he won, you won too. When he won, you won. That's why I say, when he rose, you rose. Come on, you are seated together with Christ in heavenly places. The real you is not this flesh. The real you is the spirit in this tent. Now that spirit is seated in heavenly places, and that spirit understands that what this body sees is not all that there is, because there is something greater. And when I operate, I don't operate from the earthly realm, I operate from heaven. When I pray from heaven, commanding change on earth. When I speak, I'm speaking from heaven, commanding change in the earth. Talk to me, somebody. Hallelujah. Jesus sealed Satan's defeat. He sealed it. It is sealed. He is defeated. He's not coming back again to defeat the devil. The devil has been defeated already. Say amen to that. Satan has no power over you unless you give it to him. Satan has no authority over you unless you give it to him. You understand? You must understand that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus did a final work. He did a finished work. He completed. His last words on the cross were, "It is finished." Tell your neighbor, "It is finished." And the finished work was the seal of his defeat. of Satan's defeat. Now, you see, it's exactly as I explained to you. You get into that ring and your opponent has been disarmed. It means he's got no weapons. Talk to me, somebody. He's got no weapons. You know when you go to the bank, you find there's a security there, and he's got ammunition, he's got his weapons. Why? In case a robber would come, so that he can retaliate. But if his weapons were taken, and a robber were to come, what would he do? He'd surrender. Now that is what Satan done before you were born again. He ran havoc in your life. And the day you received Jesus, you received weapons. God gave you weapons. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They are mighty in God to the pulling down of strongholds. You are the one that has the weapon. The weapon is the blood, and the weapon is the word. You need to use the blood, and you need to use the word. Talk to me, somebody. Those are your weapons. When the enemy comes, come and talk to me, somebody. You have already on you the whole armor of God. The helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness. Having girded your loins with the truth, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, holding up the shield of faith to quench the fiery darts of the evil one, holding up the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Come and talk to me. When you look at it, come on. Putting on the full armor of God is putting on Christ. That is what Paul is speaking about to the Ephesian church. Clothe yourself with Christ. He is your salvation. He is your righteousness. He is the truth. Talk to me, somebody. He is the way. He'll tell your feet which way to go. Talk to me, somebody. And he is your faith. Your faith is in him. He is the word, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. He's telling you, put on Christ. And after having done all, stand. You see, when you stand, Satan can listen, talk to me, somebody. When you are standing, Satan will be at your mercy.
Amen.
You see, the serpent will bruise the heel. But you've been given the power to stand so that you can trample over him.
Amen.
I say you can trample over him. That diagnosis, you trample over it in the name of Jesus. That evil report, you trample over it in the name of Jesus. Come and talk to me. I'm speaking to somebody in this place. The doctor may have said you cannot bear a child, but I'm here to tell you to take that diagnosis and trample it underfoot. Because listen, come and talk to me, somebody. I know of a woman in the Bible, her womb was closed. She didn't go to any doctor. She didn't go to any physician. She went to the physician of physicians. She went to Jehovah God. She went to her creator, because it is the creator who can open the womb. It is the creator who can close the womb. Are you hearing me, somebody? Hallelujah. You can just receive the word this morning. Hallelujah. Abraham had to receive that word. Sarah had to receive that word. When God said, about this time next year, I will remember you. About this time next year, I will revisit you. Talk to me, somebody. God is a God who fulfills his promise. Hallelujah. And the same God who said, behold, I am coming. He's coming again. Hallelujah. The coming of Christ is near. Tell somebody, Christ is coming. Praise the Lord. Now I want to speak to you this morning about activating the power of the resurrection inside of you. The book of Philippians chapter number 3 verse 10. The Bible says, I want to know Christ. I want to know Christ. I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. I want to know him. Not only do I want to know him, I want to experience that power. Now, brothers and sisters in Christ, hallelujah. Praise God. I shared with you earlier, Christianity without the resurrection is empty. There is no Christianity without the resurrection. The resurrection is at the core of what we believe, what we receive and experience in the earth and thereafter in heaven. It is at the core of our belief. Every Christian believes and receives salvation, but sadly, most aren't operating in the fullness of the direction of the resurrection power that is available unto us. Most are not operating in it because they think it's going to come from somewhere. Let me tell you, resurrection power, the resurrection power is within you. The resurrection power is within you. You see, when the prophet went and he laid over that child that was dead, the prophet understood that there was something on the inside of him that he would impart into this child. When he spoke to the widow and he said, go and make for me first and come, because thus says the Lord, he understood that there's something on the inside that he can release, that would release power into the flour and power into the oil, that it will not cease and it will last for a period of 3 years. I need to speak to somebody in this place this morning that can come and talk to me, that can receive this, to say that there is a power that's driving within me. It's the resurrection power of the living God, and I can release it by speaking. When I speak an anointed word. An anointed word is a word that has power. It has come and talk to me. It is filled with faith. I'm speaking faith. I'm speaking life. Hallelujah. Praise God, somebody. Listen, we've got many Christians. When challenges come, they're running to and fro, from pastor to pastor, church to church, evangelist to evangelist. They're running all over the show, but they forget about Philippians 3 verse 10, oh, that I might know Christ and experience the resurrection power that he has. We shouldn't be running from pillar to post. We should be running to Jesus. We should be running to the Messiah. Pastor Sharon shared this morning about when you wake up in the morning, you shouldn't wake up first and the first thing begin to phone your friend or your relative to ask him to help you. The first thing you should do is go on your knees and run to God, because it is God who blessed you with that pain. The same God who created that pain for you is the same God who come through for you in that pain. Because your friend will tell you, sorry, I can't help you. You'll have to wait a few months, or you'll have to wait until things get right with me, because I'm still not yet right. But the same God that blessed you this morning, the same God who blessed you for a new day, 24 hours, is the same God who can visit you the very same day. You don't have to wait a month. You don't have to wait a season. Would God come and talk to me, somebody? God lives in a realm that is known as eternity, and is given unto you and I through the resurrection. He's given us Zoe. Zoe is the life of God. Zoe is life as God has it. That is what God has given unto you and I as his children. Somebody say, I have Zoe.
I have Zoe.
It means you have the life of God. That means that when you speak the word. Come on, talk to me. The words that you carry are anointed. They have power. Hallelujah. Praise God. You see, that anointing dwells within you. And it's that same anointing that removes burdens and destroys yokes. What does a yoke do? If you look at a yoke, the yoke is that they put on the oxen. It's heavy. You find many Christians, they're walking like that, carrying a yoke that you shouldn't carry, that Jesus carried on your behalf already. He destroyed the yoke. Come on. He destroyed the yoke. And when the yoke is destroyed, you can stand up straight. And you can take your rightful place in this life. Talk to me. Somebody say, I don't know about you. Tell me, I don't know about you. But I'm taking my place. I'm taking my place. I have resurrection power inside of me. Hallelujah. Praise God. I want to share with you quickly three things. Number one, in experiencing the resurrection power day after day, number one, you've got to believe it. What you believe is everything. What you believe is everything. Say, what you believe is everything. Hallelujah. You've got to believe it. In other words, believe that God has redeemed you. Believe that God has freed you. Believe it. Believe that God has healed you. Praise God. You see, being born again does not activate that power inside of you. You've got to believe it. Believing is key. Believing is what activates the power of the resurrection in your life. Believing activates it. You see, let me tell you something. You are anointed. You are anointed. Tell somebody, you are anointed. The anointing I share with you is the presence of God. You see, when the prophet would, when he anointed the king, it means that the presence of God came upon that individual. You see, Samuel anointed David. He anointed David. When David stood before Goliath, who you think was standing before Goliath? It was God. Because God was with him. Now you are anointed. Jesus. I said, now you are anointed. I said, now you are anointed. Are you getting this thing? You understand that? You are anointed. The presence of God is with you. The presence of God is within you. It's upon you. It's all around you. That's why even the apostles, when they walk, just their shadow healed the sick. You know, listen, have you ever thought to yourself, wherever you walk, your shadow is there? Have you ever thought that, man, as I walk, how many sick people have been healed purely by the shadow? Because when Jesus responded and he said, I am, all those soldiers fell. When the tomb was opened, those soldiers fell. Catherine Kuhlman, that to make she had her own entry and exit to the airport. Because wherever she would go, people would fall under the power of God. They would fall under the anointing. Such power. Power. Do you understand what you carry? Do you understand what you have within you? That when David slew Goliath, the Bible says all the Philistines started running. Helter scatter. He says, though the enemy come one way, you scatter on seven different ways. Amen. Praise God. Now the day you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the day you responded to the altar call, you activated the power. Somebody say, I am activated. Okay. The day you receive Jesus, That power was made available unto you and you activated it. Because listen, if you didn't activate it, you would still be saying, I'm only a sinner saved by grace. You were a sinner saved by grace. Past tense. You're no longer a sinner. You are now a child of the living God. Come on, talk to me, somebody. You are now a child of the living God. So you activated it by believing. And that same believing that you used to activate the power of the resurrection, which translated you from being unrighteous to being righteous, from being unholy to being holy, is the same power, it's the same believing and the same faith that you will use to get you healed, that you use to get you delivered. Come and talk to me. This thing doesn't stop. It's like I shared with you on Friday. Somebody that has received Jesus for the very first time is on fire for the Lord. They want to save the whole town. They want to save the whole nation. They want to save the world. They are on a love mission because they've experienced the love of God. And that is what Jesus was all about. Jesus was on a love mission, winning the world back for God, winning the people of God back to God, getting God's family back into the kingdom of God. Now that person you find it telling everybody under the sun about Jesus, and you get some Christians who've been Christians for way too long and their fire has also burnt out. They say, it will last, you see, it will soon wear out. They say that because they themselves got lukewarm and then they got cold. And then they think everybody else is like them. No, you must tell yourself, I will not grow. Come and talk to me. Say, I will not go warm. I will not go warm. I will not go cold. I will not go cold. Hallelujah. You on fire. Because when you are cold, come and talk to me, you go cold turkey. Cold turkey means that when the enemy comes, you freeze. You don't know what to say. You don't know what to do. But when you're on fire, you can speak in the name of Jesus. When you're on fire, you can go on your knees and you can pray and you can turn the situation around. When you are on fire, you can take the word of God and you can speak it. You see, what the devil said you cannot do, what the devil said you cannot have, I'm here to tell you, you can, you can, you can. You are in a covenant with God. God has said, I covenant you to myself. He's covenanted you to himself. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, somebody. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Devil may tell you one thing, but you tell him what God says. Amen. You tell him what the word of God says that the blood of Jesus has done for you. That is what you do. Talk to me, somebody. Amen. Hallelujah. Through believing in Jesus, you receive deliverance, you receive forgiveness of sin. You receive righteousness, you've been made right with God. Amen. Man, that's a lot of power. I say that's a lot of power. Because everything that the psychologists themselves and medical science itself could not do in transforming the life of an individual, the gospel of Jesus Christ of Nazareth has the power to do. What we need is the gospel. The gospel is the solution to the problems in the world. Talk to me, somebody.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The second thing you need to do, I just shared with you now, is speak it. You see, once you believe that that resurrection power is inside of you, once you believe that that anointing is inside of you, once you believe that that faith is within you, you've got to speak it. You speak it. You speak faithful words to release the blessing of God into your life. You speak words of faith, full with faith, to release the blessing. Because God has brought you back into the blessing. The book of Galatians says that through Jesus, because we are Christ's, then we are Abraham's. You see, he had to be crucified so that the blessing of Abraham might come upon us too, who were once Gentiles. Talk to me, somebody. Hallelujah. Praise God. The third thing we need to do is act on it. The third thing we need to do is act on it. Tell the neighbor, act.
Yes.
Act.
Yes.
You see, it's amazing how we find the Gospels. We find the Gospels. All the Gospels speak about the crucifixion, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. And after he rose from the dead, he had been to accomplish and finish the works in heaven. We find that Jesus appears to the disciples. He appears to them. And he starts, what do you think he was doing before his ascension? He was downloading into their spirits the principles of the kingdom. And that's why he said, you will receive power. You will receive dunamis. The Greek word for power is dunamis. Dunamis means man. That's where we get the word dynamite from. You see, you are going through your hardships trying to fight it on your own. But Jesus says now, you will receive dynamite.
Amen.
After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you.
Amen.
You see, when the body of Jesus was there in the tomb, it was considered dead. But when the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Him who raised Him from the dead, entered His body, it gave life to His body. You understand what I'm saying? That life that entered that body, it blew that door away. And you have within you the power of God. When Jesus says you will receive power after that the Holy Ghost comes upon you, he was saying you will receive dynamite. Dunamis, the dynamic ability to cause and effect change. That's what you have. You have the dynamic. Man, this is a power. It is dynamic in working. It is dynamic in working. It is loaded with dynamite. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Praise the Lord Jesus. Satan's defeat was sealed by the resurrection. Here's the thing. We have to enforce it by acting on it. Because the very same power that raised Jesus from the dead is living on the inside of you. God, come on, talk to me. God raised us up together and made us all to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Satan is defeated. When he tries to bring the curse back into your life, he is trespassing. When you go past, you know, you go past certain places, and you see that sign, no trespassers allowed. What does that mean? You dare walk there. You dare jump the fence. You dare cross the line. You'll get arrested. So when Satan tries to bring the curse into your life, back into your life, he's trespassing. You've got to enforce what Jesus has done. Hallelujah. And let me tell you something, you not run away from him. You have the authority, you have the authority to make him leave.
Amen.
Jesus says, in my name they'll cast out demons and devils. In my name they lay hands on the sick and have them recover. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall in no means hurt them. Hallelujah. Talk to me, somebody. I don't know what's been happening in your life, but today is a day where you can serve notice.
Amen.
Today is a day where you can serve notice. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You apply the name of Jesus, you apply the blood of Jesus and God's power to every situation in your life. I'm going to say that again. You apply the name of Jesus, you apply the blood of Jesus and God's power into every situation in your life. When sickness comes your way, apply the blood of Jesus. That's resurrection power. If that tries to take up a residence in your life, apply the blood of Jesus. Declare the curse is over in your life and the enemy is defeated, and claim the triumph that Jesus won for you on the cross. Got to apply the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm going to close with this statement. Don't ever accept defeat in your life. Don't ever accept defeat in your life. Jesus paid a price too high for you to accept anything less than total and complete victory in your life. You see, what you have today is what you have been believing and trusting God for yesterday. It's what you've been allowing. Don't settle for less than God's best for you. The blood of Jesus, come and talk to me. God gave his best. His best was Jesus. The best was his blood. He paid a price too high for you to settle for anything less than the best. Hallelujah. Come and talk to me, somebody. Tell your neighbor, I don't know about you, but I'm not settling for second best. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'll give you part two next week, which will be the concluding of this message. I know you've received something today. Come and give the Lord praise. Come and give him praise. And he has made you free. The Bible says, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Hallelujah. Consider this, a woman or a young lady that is born into poverty, is born into a poverty-stricken community. You understand what I'm saying now? And this woman one day, a rich man, a wealthy man, richest man in the entire world, the entire universe, comes to her and says, I want to marry you. I want to make you my wife. Huh? I want to make you my wife. The two of them get married. Marriage is a covenant. It's a covenant. So that woman and that man enter into covenant with each other. That covenant says, what belongs to the man belongs to the woman. Everything that is his, it becomes hers. She is free to use it. It's been made available to her. Come and talk to me. My question to you is she still the same poor young girl that she was? The status has changed. You see, once we were a people without God, a people alienated from the life of God and the promises of God. But God demonstrated his own love toward us in that whilst we were without God, whilst we were yet sinners, born into sin, born into the curse of poverty, of sickness, of disease, whilst we were there, God demonstrated his own love towards us, and that once we were in that state, Christ died for us. God saw the potential that is within you, that you yourself don't see. And in coming to Jesus, you've been reconciled to God. Your status has changed. You are no longer forgotten. You are no longer forsaken. You are no longer cursed. You've been translated into the kingdom of the Son of His light. You are a loved child. Your parents may have told you that you were a mistake, you were an unplanned baby. Let me tell you something, you eradicate that from your life because you were God's plan. Your parents may have unplanned you, but God planned you. God planned you. God purposed your birth. Maybe I'm just feeling in my spirit. You get, you know, sometimes parents can say really nasty, wicked things to their children. You know, maybe you may feel that, you know, you were born out of love. Not love, but out of love. In other words, you feel that your parents did not love each other. You feel that you were never a loved child. But let me tell you, you are a loved child because God loves you. You are God's loved child. You are God's loved child. Come and talk to me, somebody. I'm speaking this morning. You're watching me wherever you're watching me from. There are parents too that I'm speaking to. You may have said to your children, God, you know, this made me angry, that made me angry. Let me tell you, impart life and love into your children. Because we find that in the society we live in, it's sad. We counsel many people, you know, it is amazing that it is sickening, it is actually sickening. When you hear that a child will tell you that I was never a planned baby, when a child will tell you that, you know, my mother never loved my father never loved my mother, that's why, you know, I never grew up with my parents. And the child grows up thinking that they were born out of hate and not out of love. They were born out of spite. But let me tell you, that spite is being eradicated this morning. It's being eradicated this morning. You are a loved child. God loves you. God loves you, child. God loves you. Embrace His love. The Bible says that God is love. And you are an offspring of God. That means you are love. You can receive His love this morning. You can receive His mercy this morning. You were in God's plan. You were on God's calendar. It's not the end of your life. It's not the end of your story. God paid a high price for you. And He bought you out to bring you in. He's bringing you into something better. You just hold on. Come on, stand up in this place. Father, we just worship you this morning. Father, we just give you thanks and we give you praise. Father, we give you worship, we give you the glory, we give you the honor. Jesus, 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 come on, praise the worship team, come, join me here. Selech na hu, mamikaski alele maha. Sholei mago huska hakata. Hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, Father, we just thank you this morning for your great love, for your looking after us. Father, we thank you. Thank you for Jesus Christ, your Son, who paid the price for us. Thank you that the price has been paid for in full. There's nothing outstanding, O God. Thank you, Lord, that we've received mercy, O God. By the blood we have remission. By the blood we have been redeemed. By the blood we have been justified. By the blood we have been declared righteous. Father, we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, your Son. Father, we thank you this morning that, Lord God, we can clothe ourselves with Christ Jesus. And we can walk, O God, in the power of Christ. Oh, that we might know him and experience the glories of his resurrection, O God. Father, we just want to thank you this morning. We thank you that the tomb is empty, O God. We thank you, Lord God, the tomb is empty. Oh, and Jesus Christ has filled our hearts and filled our lives. He dwells within us, O God. In him we live, in him we move, in him we breathe, in him we have our being. Oh, Lord God, we thank you this morning for the gospel of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, O God, we thank you and we bless you, O God. Father, we pray that you will open doors of utterance, O God. So that, Lord, the message of the gospel can reach the unreachable, can tell the untold, O God. Lord, we just thank you this morning, O God. We thank you, Lord, for souls. Souls that are being saved. Souls that are coming to Jesus. We thank you, O God. Lord, we bless and praise you. Lord, we worship you, Lord. Worthy of praise and glory are you, Lord. Before I release the final benediction, if you have not received the Lord Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, or if you have missed the mark, you once served God and you don't serve him anymore, or you just feel you've grown cold, but you want to, you know, to reestablish your faith in Christ. You want to make things right with God. If that is you, this place, every eye closed, every head bowed, if that is you, I want you to raise your right hand where I can see it. I see that hand. Come on, raise your right hand where I can see it. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see that hand. I see that hand. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. If you raise your hand, I want to call you to the front. Come take a step of faith. Every eye closed, every head bowed. Take a step of faith. Come to the front. Jesus is here today.
I am born again.
I'm a child.
Come on, let's go. Come on, carry him with that beat. Carry him with that beat. Don't worry. Thank you, Jesus.